Women's Rights Pioneers, Grimké, Mott, and Howe, by Sanderson Beck. Whatever it is morally right for man to do, it is morally right for woman to do. Angelina Grimké, Letters to Catherine Beecher. In the late 16th century, six Indian tribes were confederated into the Iroquois League for the sake of peace. Nevertheless, the warriors' desire for individual glory led to much fighting. On at least one occasion, the women organized a non-cooperation campaign to stop a war in the same way that Aristophanes had dramatized it in his play Lysistrata. Many people came to America for reasons of conscience and religious liberty, such as Roger Williams and later the Pacifist Society of Friends. Anne Hutchinson spoke so persuasively in Boston about conscience and inner spiritual guidance that she was brought to trial and banished from Massachusetts. In 1657, this colony outlawed the Society of Friends. Several friends disobeyed the law and taught about the inner light in Massachusetts. Three of them were hanged for this crime, including Mary Dyer. In a March 1776 letter, Abigail Adams reminded her husband John that all men would be tyrants if they could, and warned that the ladies would rebel if they were bound by laws in which they had no voice or representation. That year, taxpaying women in New Jersey were given the right to vote until it was taken away by the legislature in 1807. In Boston, girls were allowed to attend public schools during the summer from 1789 to 1822. In 1818, Hannah Mather Crocker published the pamphlet Observations on the Real Rights of Women, suggesting that if they received the same education, they would improve equally. Frances Wright was born in Scotland and read with excitement about the republicanism of the American Revolution. She visited the United States in 1824 with Lafayette. She bought 2,000 acres near Memphis, Tennessee, and established the Neshoba community, where slaves could work to gain their freedom in 5 years. But the land was poor and cooperation was difficult. Wright and socialist Robert Owen promoted birth control in the Free Inquirer in New York and lived together. Frances Wright lectured from Boston to New Orleans in 1828 and 1829 for sexual equality. She called upon fathers and husbands to end the mental bondage they imposed on their daughters and wives, warning, "Whenever we establish our own pretensions upon the sacrificed rights of others, we do in fact impeach our own liberties." She was criticized severely for believing in sexual freedom and miscegenation. In 1830, the 34 slaves were taken from Neshoba to Haiti, where they were freed. Emma Willard gave speeches to raise money and founded the Troy Female Seminary in 1821. And 2 years later, Catherine Beecher began a seminary for girls in Hartford, Connecticut. The first public schools for girls were started in Worcester, Massachusetts in 1824 and in New York in 1826. But there were not many others until after the Civil War. When Quaker Prudence Crandall advertised to add Negroes to her girls' school in 1833, the school closed. But she began teaching 17 Negro girls and did so for 18 months despite persecution and harassment. Oberlin College in Ohio began in 1833 by accepting males and females of any race. Mary Lyon founded Mount Holyoke as a seminary in 1837, and it eventually became a college. Beginning in 1838, Dorothea Dix did much to expose and improve conditions in prisons and insane asylums. Women were active in the abolitionist movement. when they were not allowed to join the American Anti-Slavery Society at its founding in 1833, they formed the Philadelphia Female Anti-Slavery Society, and in New York, 4 years later, the National Female Anti-Slavery Society. When a mob of several thousand abducted Garrison while he was speaking to their Boston meeting in 1835, Maria Weston Chapman led the women out walking in pairs, holding the hand of a colored sister. That year, Lydia Maria Child published in 2 volumes a multicultural examination of women entitled History of the Condition of Women in Various Ages and Nations. From Asia, Africa, and the Pacific Islands to Europe and America, she showed how marriage laws treated women as drudges, sexual objects, child bearers, and child rearers, or property. She discussed how laws differed on virginity, adultery, polygamy, divorce, concubinage, and prostitution, noting how women were treated differently than men in these and in relation to education, political power, business, and religion. The Grimké sisters, Sarah and Angelina, who had left their South Carolina home and its slaves in 1828, joined the Quakers in Philadelphia and worked for the abolition of slavery and women's rights. In 1837, Sarah Grimké's Letters on the Equality of the Sexes were published in the New England Spectator and were reprinted in The Liberator. She speculated that women were the first to suffer from man's lust for dominion after the fall. All history attests that man has subjected woman to his will, used her as a means to promote his selfish gratification, to minister to his sensual pleasures, to be instrumental in promoting his comfort, but never has he desired to elevate her to the rank she was created to fill. He has done all he could to debase and enslave her mind, and now he looks triumphantly on the ruin he has wrought, and says the being he has thus deeply injured is his inferior. Sarah believed that men and women were created equal, and argued that whatever it is morally right for a man to do is right for a woman. But she has surrendered her rights and accepted the privileges given her by men. Sarah noted the disproportionate value set on the time and labor of men as compared to that of women. Men have exerted brutal power over women, such that in most countries the name husband means also tyrant. Brute force is especially egregious in the homes of the poor, where the woman is made a drudge. Sarah Grimké signed her letters, "Thine in the Bonds of Womanhood." Angelina Grimké went on a speaking tour and drew large audiences of more than 1,000 people. While she was speaking in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania Hall was torn down and set aflame. She argued that men would find women as their equal much more valuable than women as their inferior. She worked herself to exhaustion, collapsed, and nearly died of typhoid fever. In 1838, Angelina was reported to have said, "I ask no favors for my sex. I surrender not our claim to equality. All I ask of our brethren is that they will take their feet from off our necks and permit us to stand upright on the ground which God has designed us to occupy." Women began getting petitions signed to stop the spread of slavery, to ban it in the District of Columbia and in interstate trade, as well as for its complete abolition. When their right to petition was challenged, ex-President John Quincy Adams presented the petitions himself in the United States Congress. The men's and women's anti-slavery societies merged in 1839. But the next year, when 8 American women delegates were barred from the British Anti-Slavery Society's meeting in London, Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton decided to organize a convention in the United States for the rights of women. Transcendentalist Margaret Fuller wrote the essay, "The Great Lawsuit," in the Dial in 1840, calling for complete equality for women in education, industry, and politics. She expanded these ideas into the book Woman in the 19th Century, which she completed in 1844. Since women are in some ways weaker than men, they ought to have legal protection to make oppression impossible. She wanted every arbitrary barrier thrown down that would prevent women from being as free as men. She believed that such equality would allow a divine energy to pervade nature previously unknown in history. Humanity will be ripe for this when the inward and outward freedom for women is recognized as a right, not merely yielded as a concession. Fuller saw male and female as complementary in nature, representing two sides of a radical dualism. Male energy, power, and intellect are balanced by female harmony, beauty, and love. She believed that women excelled in spiritual intuition. She pioneered the modern psychological concept that men have feminine aspects while women have masculine qualities. If men would just remove the barriers, women could be independent and self-reliant. The Industrial Revolution resulted in many women working long hours in factories with unhealthy conditions. The first labor strike involving only women workers was at Dover, New Hampshire in 1828. In the 1840s, several strikes led by Sarah Bagley of the Lowell Female Labor Reform Association were aimed at reducing the workday to 10 hours. Other reforms in this period allowed married women to own property in most states. Magazine editor Sarah Josepha Hale promoted professional and physical education for women so that they could be physicians. She also exposed the menace of corsets. Many women liberated their bodies by wearing more comfortable clothing and were called bloomers. For 10 years, from 1843, Clarina Howard Nichols promoted women's rights as the editor of the Windham County Democrat in Vermont. In 1851, Myrtilla Minor opened a school for Negro girls in Washington, D.C., and soon had 40 students. Lucretia Mott was born in 1793, was the mother of six, and had been ordained as a minister by her Quaker meeting when she was 28. She criticized conservative attitudes in the Religious Society of Friends and advocated not using the products of slavery. When William Lloyd Garrison organized the All-Male American Anti-Slavery Society in Philadelphia in 1833, Lucretia organized the Philadelphia Female Anti-Slavery Society 4 days later. Angelina and Sarah Grimké joined. As they began to address mixed audiences, the woman question arose. The controversy erupted at the first annual convention of anti-slavery women on May 17, 1838, when a mob, angry that black and white women were meeting together before a promiscuous audience of men and women, burned the new Pennsylvania Hall to the ground with the apparent approval of the mayor and the police. From there, the mob went to attack the Mott's home, but someone led them in the wrong direction. Lucretia Mott had led the evacuation of the hall, suggesting that the women link arms in pairs of one white woman and one black woman. She calmly awaited the mob at her home with her husband and their guests. The next day, the women met again and decided to increase their efforts. At the following year's convention, Lucretia refused police protection and ignored advice to keep the races apart on the streets. A few months later, her bravery prevented an abolitionist friend from being tarred and feathered in Delaware. She boldly pleaded with them to take her, as she was the chief offender, saying, "I ask no courtesy at your hands on account of my sex." In 1840, Lucretia Mott went to London for the World Anti-Slavery Convention. Even though she represented two organizations, she was not admitted. However, she met Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and in 1848 they organized the Seneca Falls Convention for Women's Rights. Lucretia Mott spoke always for the equal and balanced empowerment of women and men harmoniously blended so that there would be less war, injustice, and intolerance in the world than now. She remained an active non-resistant and pacifist even during the Civil War, supporting conscientious objectors and recommending only moral force. Abby Kelly had an equal partnership with her husband, Stephen S. Foster. They alternated going on speaking tours and taking care of their child and the farm. Once, when they were both arrested in Ohio for handing out anti-slavery literature on the Sabbath, Abby refused to cooperate and was carried to jail. After the Civil War, they refused to pay taxes on their farm because women were not represented in government. The origin of Mother's Day is an interesting story of women's efforts for peace. In 1858, Anna Reeves Jarvis organized Mother's Works Days in West Virginia in order to improve sanitation in Appalachian communities. Julia Ward Howe and her husband Samuel Gridley Howe worked with the U.S. Sanitary Commission during the Civil War, when more people died of disease because of poor sanitation than were killed in battle. After meeting President Lincoln, Julia Ward Howe wrote new words to the popular song John Brown's Body, which became the battle hymn of the Republic. After witnessing the devastation of this war, in 1870, when another Franco-Prussian war broke out, she wrote the following declaration, which became known as the Mother's Day Proclamation. Arise then, women of this day, arise all women who have hearts, whether your baptism be of water or of tears. Say firmly, we will not have questions answered by irrelevant agencies. Our husbands will not come to us reeking with carnage for caresses and applause. Our sons shall not be taken from us to unlearn all that we have been able to teach them of charity, mercy, and patience. We, the women of one country, will be too tender of those of another country to allow our sons to be trained to injure theirs. From the voice of a devastated earth, a voice goes up with our own. It says, disarm, disarm. The sword of murder is not the balance of justice. Blood does not wipe our dishonor, nor violence indicate possession. As men have often forsaken the plow and the anvil at the summons of war, let women now leave all that may be left of home for a great and earnest day of counsel. Let them meet first, as women, to bewail and commemorate the dead. Let them solemnly take counsel with each other as to the means whereby the great human family can live in peace. Each bearing after his own time the sacred impress, not of Caesar, but of God. In the name of womanhood and humanity, I earnestly ask that a General Congress of Women without limit of nationality may be appointed and held at some place deemed most convenient, and at the earliest period consistent with its objects, to promote the alliance of the different nationalities, the amicable settlement of international questions, the great and general interests of peace. Julia Ward Howe proposed June 2nd as Mother's Day for Peace in 1872 and went on to work with Lucy Stone in the women's suffrage movement. In 1874, she published Sex and Education, with essays disputing theories that women were inferior to men and thus should have separate education. Howe co-founded the Association for the Advancement of Women, AAW, in 1873 and was its president until 1881. She wrote a biography of Margaret Fuller in 1883. In 1890, the AAW was transformed into the General Federation of Women's Clubs, and she directed its activities while founding clubs on her lecture tours. Julia Ward Howe continued to promote June 2nd as Mother's Day for Peace until she died in 1910. Anna Jarvis, the daughter of Anna Reeves Jarvis, began a campaign to celebrate Mother's Day by giving 500 women carnations at her St. Andrew's Church in Grafton, West Virginia in 1907. And the following year, that church honored mothers on May 10th. In 1909, Mother's Day services were held in 46 states. In 1914, the U.S. Congress passed a Mother's Day resolution that was signed by President Wilson. Anna Jarvis disliked the commercialization of the celebration that made profits from selling flowers and cards, which she considered a lazy excuse for a good letter. In 1923, she sued New York Governor Al Smith and was even arrested for protesting.
Thank you.